At Amplify, we are getting rid of all banking fees, so you have a little extra to sprinkle around. No fees equals more sprinkles. Amplify.
Hello, I'm Emily Gibson, co-founder of ATX TV, and this is Jen Morgan, our director of programming, and we are so glad you're joining us for this deeper dive into one of our favorite series this year, High School, based on the best-selling memoir by Tegan and Sara Quin.
There are so many things I love about the series, but one thing in particular is how it embraces that period of being a teenager where you're really discovering yourself for the first time. What you want to wear, what kind of music you want to listen to, who your friends are, who your crushes are. So in that spirit, what were you like in high school?
Well, since you just said crushes, I was definitely a little crush crazy. But besides that, I did split my time equally between group study sessions, theater rehearsals, and marching band. So that pretty much describes me, but I thoroughly enjoyed all of them. I was definitely an angsty, dramatic teen. But what about you?
Well, I went from wearing a lot of band tees and pants with an unnecessary amount of zippers to sort of being the out, but not totally out queer kid who did a lot of academic decathlon. So, and I did listen to a lot of Tegan and Sara. So at least I had that going for me.
That we can agree on. It's safe to say that you and I could gush about Tegan and Sara and this incredible group of creatives for the entire length of the panel, but we're not going to put them through that. Instead, we'll just say, the show is excellent, and if you haven't tuned in yet, please go check out all of season one for free on Freevee.
I'd also like to thank our partners at Amplify Credit Union for making this conversation possible. We love being able to work with local partners whenever possible, and this year Amplify went completely fee-free for its customers. It's now working to end bank fees for all Texans. To learn more about them, go to goamplify.com.
All right, well, it's time for us to go practice our extremely underwhelming cover of Tegan Didn't Go to School Today.
I mean, I didn't think it was that bad.
But first, we're going to hand it over to our wonderful moderator to kick things off, Anthony.
Hey, thank you, Emily. Thank you, Jen, so much. And also, in case you're curious, the kind of kid I was in high school, I was the editor of the newspaper and the yearbook, still very closeted, but, you know, here we are. But anyway, I'm so glad to be here to celebrate high school. And just to give you context on GLAAD for anyone that may not be familiar with what we do, GLAAD is the world's largest LGBTQ media advocacy organization. So what that means is that every single day we are working with and through media to make sure that there are accurate, inclusive, just well done storylines and representations about our LGBTQ community. So that means film, television, music, streaming, video games, and beyond. So clearly, we really hope and push and pray for projects like High School. I mean, we all know Tegan and Sara are such icons, rock stars in that world, but then to see it all come together on this amazing series, I'm so excited for this conversation. We're gonna have Tegan and Sara, the cast, crew. So I guess without further ado, let's start welcoming everyone. First up, let's bring in the executive producer, writer, and director, the amazing Clea DuVall. Yay.
Hi. How's it going? Hi, Anthony.
Good to see you. All right. Let's also bring in Laura Kittrell, who's also the executive producer and writer. Then let's bring in Tegan and Sara, both also executive producers on this series. And then last but not least, Railey Gilliland, who plays Tegan in this series. Are we all here? There we go. Well, first off, congratulations. And I want to remind everyone, the entire series is available right now on Freevee. You can check it out. You can binge it. You'll love it. But Clea, let me start with you because I would love to know like how this project came into your world because you are such a amazing filmmaker. I mean, were you just super fans of Tegan and Sara? But I feel like there's more to the story than just that.
I mean, I am a fan of Tegan and Sara, but we've been friends for 15 years and we've worked together a few different times. And they sent me an early copy of their book and I read it in a day and fell in love with it and called Tegan the next day and said, you know, I love your book and you shouldn't just, you know, give it to someone else to adapt, let me adapt it. And that way you guys can be a part of it and have a say in how your story is being portrayed on screen.
I love that.
She said, get out of here.
Get out of here. Yeah.
And I was like, new phone, who dis?
Yeah.
But, you know, Laura, let me come to you, because here's the thing. GLAAD loves this series. The community loves it. But not only that, critics love it too. I mean, everyone, I mean, major praise happening. I'm so happy to hear that. But I mean, what is it like to have something that's both super impactful for our community, but also just praised in general?
Incredible. I think it's like the responses. I mean, I know that we were confident that we'd made a thing that we were proud of and that was a show that we would have wanted to see ourselves. But I think the critical response is like far beyond our wildest dreams and puts a lot of pressure on us to keep it up if we're able to do more.
Tegan, I mean, we've chatted a lot about this, but it's like, you know, to make music is one thing, to write a book is one thing, but then to see it all on screen, it's gotta be kind of, you know, surreal. What was it like when you literally saw your life kind of just unfolding and being, you know, put on screen for the world to see?
Yeah, I mean, look, it's obviously very, very, very surreal, but also we had, you know, 100% faith in Clea and Laura and just the incredible team that surrounded the whole show. You know, from the early parts of this process, we just knew we were in good hands, and we'd found two people who really understood our story, and they were perfect to take the story to television. And, you know, and then once we got on set, we were just so, you know, excited to see it come alive. It was extremely weird and strange, but at no point did I lose faith in the amazing cast and the amazing direction and writing. It was all really cool. And it's amazing to be a part of television and to have our story out there. But like, we're very detached from it. It's not really Tegan and Sara in my mind anymore. It's just a story about queer women growing up in the 90s, you know?
Sara, you know, on that, to find the people to play you to was, I can imagine how that, what an undertaking that would be. But then listen, Railey and Season come into your world. But for anyone that doesn't know the story of how you all kind of found them, you know, refresh us, because it's amazing.
Yeah. I mean, we would talk both privately and, you know, publicly, I guess, with our team about how challenging we thought it was going to be to find twins, hopefully, to play Tegan and Sara on the show, you know, in terms of like, I mean, there's just like so many different kinds of twins in general, but like to find twins who like felt like they embodied, you know, what I think we embody at that specifically at that age, but even now, I thought it was going to be a completely impossible task. We all like acted super confident, especially when we were pitching. We would always be like, this will be fine. It's not that big of a deal, but like truly felt really nervous. And really it was maybe the easiest part of casting. I mean, we saw a lot of twins, but before we'd even started the casting process, Tegan had sent me a TikTok actually of Railey and said, oh, this, you know, this girl is so funny and like cool and cute and weird. And don't you think this is kind of like me when I was in high school? And she's a twin and she's got a twin sister. And we both went down the rabbit hole on their multiple accounts, which is still confusing to me. I don't understand children who have multiple accounts. But anyways, we went down there's so much and so little, and I don't know, but we fell in love. And I kind of like, you know, I just sort of had that like hair standing up on, you know, my arms kind of moment where I just was like, once I saw them, I couldn't unsee them. And thankfully we got to cast them and they did an absolutely remarkable job. But, you know, I think that this is one of those situations where the algorithm and the fact that our phones are listening to us really helped, because I truly believe we were served like Season and Railey to our phones. Like it was like, we kept saying twins, 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 twins. And the algorithm was like, you want twins? Here's a couple of cuties. And then that was how it all worked out.
That's amazing. I know the phone is always listening, people. Railey, but let's come to you. I mean, you portray Tegan in this amazing series. You know, it is, like I said, one thing to be on TikTok, but then to like literally be thrust into the spotlight. I mean, you have amazing, you know, legendary filmmakers, actors as a part of this. What was it like to kind of just get thrust into this moment?
That was pretty crazy when that happened, but that was crazy, but it was a lot of fun.
Do you remember the first conversation you had with Tegan and kind of, you know, once you realized, okay, I'm going to be responsible for, you know, playing this character, tell me about what that conversation was like.
What? My conversation with Tegan?
Yeah, just kind of like in the very beginning of when, you know, like I would imagine you kind of wanted to pick her brain on playing the role.
I don't think I did that.
No,
you didn't. We just went for ramen and you jumped on my trampoline.
Yeah.
And we, which just actually was out. Probably perfectly. It's kind of like method acting. It's it's like Railey took a method approach to learning Tegan, just got on her trampoline and it all just sunk in, you know?
I love that. Railey, I will come back to you in a sec, but one of the things that I think is so important that we spotlight that maybe not everyone is fully aware of is that, you know, sitting here, it's, the show is written, it's directed, executive produced, created, acted by LGBTQ folks, which is so incredible. Clea, let me come back to you because I know in the projects, you know, thinking of The Happiest Season and the other things that you do, it is so important for you to have that authentic representation in the films that you make.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it that is part of why I wanted to, you know, switch over into writing and directing is just to have, you know, because as an actor, I've had, you know, a handful of experiences that have had a greater impact. And that has been so rewarding. And I've really seen the power of what you can do through representation on screen. And that really inspired me to start, you know, telling stories and, you know, sort of not controlling, that's a bad word, but really just like to, you know, have a say in the stories that I was telling and in a greater sense.
Laura, I think it's obvious that the show, this series is committed to portraying experiences for teens that are both relatable, but also grounded. It's so well done. Tell me a little bit about that process and how you were able to kind of take what was written, you know, in the pages and then do it so well on screen and streaming.
Yeah, I feel like something that Clea talked about a lot when I first met her and then something that we talked about as we were writing was really just wanting to respect the stories of teenagers and not have to like sensationalize them or make them something that they're not really. Like when you're living these experiences as a teenager, they feel like the biggest thing in the world and they form your life. And like, I feel like a lot of teen shows, it is like the soapier version or the like more heightened version. And it was like, let's just do the thing that it is. And it's the thing that we all connected to in the story and have lived basically. And so that was a thing that we came back to a lot.
Tegan, coming back to you. I mean, it's obvious that music is a character of the series too. I, you know, the 90s music is obviously, it's going back to the 90s when you were in high school. I mean, how cool was it? But also like, how seriously did you take, you know, finding that right music to be, you know, kind of a character in the series as well?
Well, it was part of our really early on conversations with Clea about how significant music should be in the show. And I think it's not just because we were friends with Clea or that she's an amazing writer, director, and actor. We also like respect Clea's taste in music. And we talked a lot about music early on with Clea and how it was a character in the show. And so I think like as the team came together and as we, you know, got into production, it remained a really consistent and important part of us putting together the whole show. And we had a great music supervisor and an amazing woman who scored the show. And you know, we built lots of playlists and we talked a lot about what our dream music would be. There were some letters that were written. I mean, there was a lot of we put a lot of sweat and tears into making sure we got the music we wanted. I mean, I don't remember what the number was, but it was like practically a third of our entire budget for the show when we looked at what the music would cost, you know, at that first round. And we obviously didn't spend that, but it was a really big part of the show. I mean, music is such a big part of being a young person, and it's such a big part of you know, the universal language we all speak, no matter where we come from or who we are or how we grew up or what our identity is. And I think it's a real touch point to the show, and it's a really solid entry point for the show, no matter who you are. And that's been the coolest part of seeing the show take off and to see so much of the positive feedback that's coming in. It's from such a wide range of people. And so many of them, that entry point is music. Oh God, when I was in high school, I listened to this or I dressed like that. And so I love that it remains such a big part of the show. And if we get a second season, it gets really exciting to think about, like, you know, music we get to introduce.
I love that. Sarah, let's talk about, you know, the connection. Cause I think with anything that you all do, whether it's music, your live shows, letters, books, your fans are so committed, so connected to you. What was it like to get the response from your, you know, diehard fans, just really loving and being so excited to watch the series?
I mean, I think that it's sometimes it's hard because I think that we assign, whether we realize it or not, we're assigning certain kinds of values to the feedback that we get. Like, it was very important to us that our family wasn't upset with us. You know, it was really, it was super significant to, you know, us as a team that, you know, that the reviews were good, you know, to see ourselves represented and to have the opportunity to represent ourselves feels really powerful. But I mean, as a band that sometimes struggled with reviews and really had to, like, for quite a long time had to earn the respect of critics, I know that I put a lot of value on what critics think. And so, you know, like, you're sort of doing the math all the time with people, but I think it would have really upset me if our fans didn't feel connected to this story, not just because it's a Tegan and Sara story, but because so many of our fans, I think, are looking for that storytelling representation that hasn't necessarily happened for them. And, you know, there's so many parts of this story that are unique to me and Tegan, but then there's also this, like, just like this big giant, you know, ecosystem of stuff that is relatable to so many different kinds of people and young people. And to see that early feedback from, you know, not just our fans, but from young people in general, it feels like, you know, like that's a really big win for us. It would have, nothing feels worse than thinking that, you know, you make something and then people don't get it, or that people think that you've done them wrong, or you've taken up space when somebody else's story could have taken up that space. So to see people really validating, you know, that we've done something here that feels really authentic and connecting, you know, is, I don't know, that's like a huge win.
Railey, let me come back to you. Because you are very young, obviously you're playing in high school. Let's just be real. How familiar were you with Tegan and Sara's music before you got this gig?
Well, I didn't know their music before that, but no, I didn't before that, but I listen to them now. I like them.
You have any favorite songs? Any favorite picks?
I like the new album.
That's good. That's a good answer. Absolutely. Clea, I'm going to come back to you because obviously, you know, we've established that you and Tegan and Sara are friends IRL in real life. You know, I always think, like, do I want to work with my friends? Is it going to ruin our friend? Like, you know, there's always that risk, but clearly all is okay. But, you know, what did you ever, like, think about that? And you're like, wait, what if they don't like what I'm doing? And, you know, all of the things.
I mean, constantly. We thought about it before we decided to do this together. We had several conversations about it. It wasn't just a one phone call decision. It was like, you know, it was thought and conversations. And, you know, it's challenging to work with your friends, and especially something that is, you know, so important to them and so personal to them. You know, I really wanted to get it right. I was so stressed out that they would be unhappy, you know, like, because of, you know, I know everything that they've built and how hard they've worked and how beautiful their book was. And I was like, I don't want to be the thing that, like, ruins all that stuff, you know, and I really wanted them to be happy and feel proud of it, you know, and feel like, oh, I'm glad we did that and not, we shouldn't have done that. It was really, it was pretty stressed out a lot of the time until they started. I mean, I feel like once we got on set, it started to get a little bit better. Like, when you, cause it's so hard to be like, no, trust me, the thing in here is going to come out there and it's going to be great. You know, it's a hard thing to describe to someone, but then once, you know, once we got on set, it's, you know, it started to feel a little better. And then after, you know, they started seeing cuts and they were happy, it was like a big relief.
I bet. Laura, you know, building on what you said earlier about how important it was to tell specific intentional stories about teenagers, and thinking about this being on Freevee, just so, and, you know, also available on Prime Video, there's just so much potential for worldwide people to see this. What do you hope that anyone that does watch High School, maybe that they're not even necessarily familiar with what it is, what's the message that you hope that they take away from it?
I mean, I think me personally, when I was the age of these characters, TV was so important to me in terms of, like, figuring out my sexuality. And, like, I grew up in a small town where I didn't know any other gay people. And, like, TV was where I got to meet gay people. It was also a town where I didn't really connect to the people around me in general, like even beyond my sexuality, and knowing how important TV was to me for that kind of stuff, I hope that it, yeah, helps all kinds of people feel like they're less alone.
For sure. Tegan, did you have, you know, building on that, did you have any 90s or like TV shows or any like books or anything like that that you were like, oh, that's me, I think, or like, because I think about all of the, you know, it's so true. And that's why I'm glad we push for all that, because so much of what we see on television specifically helps us also realize things about ourselves and feel represented, but it also helps the other people to be like, hey, that's not what I thought, you know, someone who was queer was or whatever.
Yeah, no, it's such a great question. I'm glad you asked it, because it gives me the opportunity to talk about collectively our favorite show, which is My So-Called Life, and which is something we talk about a lot because it's our favorite show. But growing up, obviously that had such a significant impact, you know, not just because it was, you know, a show about adolescence and longing and dating and had so much music in it, although those were things we really loved about the show. But the fact that there was, you know, queer representation was huge. You know, like the movie All Over Me, the band Murmurs. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously the Vanity Fair cover, I think it was Vanity Fair, of Cindy Crawford and Katie Lang, like that was really significant. Although they were older than us, like artists like, you know, Katie Lang and Melissa Etheridge, like knowing that they were out and queer when we were teenagers was helpful. I mean, my mom was really helpful too, although she didn't handle our coming out well. She did constantly get us queer stuff, and my dad too, we never give him credit for it, but like he took us to see Chasing Amy in theater, and like my mom rented us When Night Is Falling, and like, you know, my best friend in high school, I remember her joking one time as we went up to bed being like, your mom is like trying to make you gay, like she's getting you, you know. But I think what my mom was probably doing was trying to figure out if we were gay, and you know, so like, you know, dangling whatever she could in front of us to see how we reacted. And so, you know, there were things that we saw, but it was just far and few between. As you know, the statistics, it's still hard, you know, and representation is so complicated, because when we do see representation of a marginalized community, like the queer community, you know, we want to see the whole community represented, because it's not ever represented. And that's a lot of pressure to put on one film or one show or one book or one musical act. So, you know, it's complicated, and we thought a lot about it and talked a lot about it when we were just even thinking about how this story would go to the screen. And I think Laura and Clea did an amazing job of fictionalizing the story and are going to continue to do so in future seasons to help, you know, reflect, you know, more people. And but it still is what it is. It was the 90s, and it was just hard. You know, there was just, we always say this, I'm going to stop talking now, but we always say, like, we never even said the word gay. We used to say homosexual still. Like, that's how far we've come. This is that, like, yeah. We didn't even refer to ourselves as gay. We refer to ourselves with the clinical homosexual. Like, it's just so wild. So much has changed. And I look at people like Railey and Season, and even for them, like, there's still challenges. You know this, Anthony, from the work that you do at GLAAD. Like, being a young person now doesn't just automatically take away the stress and anxiety and otherness that you can feel as an LGBTQ person. Like, that still exists for everyone. But the more we make shows like this, I think it lessens that feeling. And it feels wonderful to be a part of, hopefully, helping young people and our people of our age to love themselves, you know?
For sure. Oh my gosh, I'm dying. Because when you said your mom would bring you queer things, I just had a flashback. So in high school, 2001, I remember my mom picking me up from high school, and she brought me a copy of Kylie Minogue's Fever album. And I was like, is she like, what's happening here? I'm like, and I wasn't out, but I was like, this is amazing. I totally identify with what you just said there. Sara, like, kind of building on with what Tegan said, you know, what were your early, I mean, I guess collectively my so-called life, but anything else maybe that we don't know that was, you know, instrumental and influential in your queer journey?
I mean, we did not have a lot of queer, like actual queer things to gravitate towards. So, I mean, just otherness in general was attractive to us. I think, you know, for me, you know, Billy Corgan and the Smashing Pumpkins was like my band. They were my heartbeat. And, you know, Billy's, at the time, like, I wasn't thinking about him as like, you know, a tall, attractive, white cis guy. I was just like, that guy seems miserable and he's very sad. And I also feel miserable and sad. And so I just really feel like he's my guy, you know? And I think just looking for those kinds of voices and those kinds of outsiders, you know, was something that I always did since I was actually quite young. And No, I was going to say too, sorry, this is just jumping on your Kylie Minogue thing. I think it's harder to be a queer guy at that age and probably even now because so much of it is actually wrapped up more, I think, in like gender presentation and stereotypes around gender. Like, at least in our family, like there was a lot that was more challenging about the 90s and gayness, but there was also a lot of cover for us in the 90s. Like, our dad and our stepdad were in construction. Our summer job was working on construction sites. Like, we were so butch. Like, we were just like, give us some lumber, give us some garbage bags, get, like, we just dressed like trash. We, you know, we were like, that was our summer job. You know, it wasn't like we had to be like lifeguarding in bathing suits or something awkward. You know, it was kind of, I don't know. There was all these sort of like these things that our parents normalized, whether they knew they were doing it or not, that allowed us to present ourselves, both our gender expression and our sexuality, in a way that didn't feel as scrutinized. Like going to raves, you know, I could see how queer raves were compared to like going to a punk show. So even though I liked punk music and I didn't really love electronic music, I was like, I will go to a rave because I can be more gay there and not feel uncomfortable. Or, you know, I can go work on a job site with my dad and I feel like myself because I'm presenting myself in clothing that makes me feel comfortable, or I'm hiding my body in a way that allows me to feel comfortable. And so, like, you know, as much as I think our show is set in a time that was less hospitable to queer people, in some ways Tegan and I had a lot of cover and a lot of you know, we got to pass as just alternative instead of like gay as fuck,
right? You know? No, totally. Because I mean, let's be real, like I was like kind of covering myself in like that skater boy gear, like just to kind of fit in and hide. And then what I really wanted to be wearing was like leather pants, like Ricky Martin. And I didn't.
Absolutely. Exactly. And like, so imagine if like one of your parents like worked adjacent to the leather industry, you would have been so stoked, you know? Like,
hey, I'm just wearing these because my dad works there. Exactly. Though.
maybe your dad was a cowboy. I don't know, but I know that it worked for us. You know,
100%. Railey, I'm going to come back to you because, you know, we did say that you and your sister, you know, very big, popular on TikTok. And in case there's any, you know, young people out there watching today, social media can be a tricky spot. And I think it's important that especially queer kids feel safe, and GLAAD is doing a lot of work to challenge the companies to get them to do things that make it a safer place. How do you kind of just balance it out and you know, keep your head on straight and not, you know, go crazy reading comments and all that stuff? What advice do you have for kids out there?
Well, when I first got on TikTok, people were really nice to me and thought I was cool. But then when my videos got more attention, people would be like mean, and I didn't know how to handle that at first. So like, I've had like 5 or 6 TikTok accounts, and like, one of them I deleted just because nobody was nice to me. Aww. And then, so I took a break from TikTok for a couple months. And then when I got back on, my mindset just kind of changed. And I just realized that, I mean, I'm going to continue to be myself and post the videos. And, you know, a lot of people tell me that like my videos make them happy, or that I make them feel that they can be themselves. And so I continue to make videos for those people and just ignore the people who are being mean.
That's so well said. And look, it's like those people that make the nasty comments, let's be real, they're just jealous of success. They're jealous of you. You know, people are nuts. But I'm GLAAD that you do make good stuff, because it does. It really does inspire so many young people. So I love that you're still doing that. Clea, have you given a thought to, like, can you imagine, okay, like, if there was a show like High School and it was available to you back when you were younger and coming up, can you imagine like what that would have been like for you?
It would have been incredible. I mean, my whole youth was really, you know, watching things and wishing that girls were gay, you know, or like projecting things onto them, or looking for bands and finding bands I really liked, and just like getting bummed out when I would find out that they were straight. Like, I think I was so desperate to find someone just to connect with, you know. And I think it would have been really, sort of like life affirming to know that there were people like me somewhere, you know, even if they were just on TV.
Yeah, Laura, same question. Let's picture it. You, young kid, turn on the TV. There's a show like High School. What would it have been like?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely agree with Clea. I feel like in a weird way, I mean, I had very similar, like watching things that were like gay adjacent, but not that I would just then graft an entire storyline onto that didn't exist, which maybe helped me become a better writer. I don't know. But as a like fully formed human, it would have made a significant difference to be like, oh, the thing that I'm struggling with and I don't totally have words for. I think something that I appreciate about our show is how much it lives in the, like, I think people talk about coming out as like, you're either not out and then you're out and you don't get to live in the gray area as much. And you live in the gray area for so long of just like, I think I'm feeling this thing, but I don't totally know what it is. And that knowing other people felt that way would have been major for me.
I love that. That's what it's all about. And listen, all the kids and any, not just kids, people that see this film, the series might be also, you know, feeling that too. Before we wrap up, and we do have time, I want to make sure I save time for some audience questions. Tegan and Sara, you are all so busy. There's a tour, there is a new album. Give anyone out there that wants to know more about what's next for you all, because I mean, you're always doing 900 things and I love it.
We are always doing 900 things. There's clearly something wrong with us. We're unwell. But, you know, honestly, one of our biggest focuses is just continuing to support the show and advocating for it online. We all got our fingers and toes crossed. We'll hear soon about a second season. And, you know, music is the engine of Tegan and Sara. We're always going to keep making music and really proud of the new record, Cry Baby, that just came out, and we'll tour next year. But, you know, Sarah's a baby, and you know, we are also like trying to make our life maybe slightly less about work all the time. My whole big thing has been that, you know, we spent a lot of time and energy building stuff at home, and we should keep taking care of that. And like, touring is hard because you leave that behind a lot. So yeah, we're just trying to find balance and focus and just tell more stories and make more things. That's just like, you know, the TNS way.
We're here for it. Sara, anything you want to add to that?
I feel like Tegan and I, actually, I feel like one of the things we really have in common, not just as friends, but as creative colleagues with Clea and Laura, is that we all work really hard. Work is not just work. It's life force. It's everything. And it's what fuels us. It's what inspires us. And I've always worked really hard, and I've always loved making things. Having become a parent recently, that is also very, it's very time consuming, and it's making me even more grateful for the space in my life to be creative, because I can see how, I can see now how privileged my life was when I could just like be like, I don't know, I'm just gonna get up and like make stuff all day or for the next year. You know, it's just now if I even get like an hour, I'm like skipping down the street, like I get to go to work, you know, like it's amazing.
Yeah, while the 1 hour or 30 minutes while your child is sleeping, you can, yeah, go back to that.
It's just amazing. Like I almost don't mean this, but like nothing has severed my life in half the way that having a child has. Like when I think about before and now, it's like they're so different, because it's even just like energetically as a creative person, I can't believe how much time I used to just have to think about making things and just like art, you know. And now I'm just like, what time is it? What's the nap? Is he coughing? Is it too soon to have wine? Is it bad to take a bath? Is it weird to give him a bath and have wine? You know, just like all the important questions, you know?
Well, speaking of important questions, I love this first question from the audience, because it's actually something I would ask. Okay. The music in the show this is from Lynn, by the way. The music in the show is so amazing. Is there a song that you wanted for the show, but we're unable to get the rights to? In other words, is there a song that got away?
I mean, I wouldn't say there was a song that got away and the show suffered because of it. There was one song, and I don't want to say what it is.
Okay.
But there was one song that we wanted to use that we couldn't use, and it was fine. And then it ended up, you know, not really... It didn't negatively impact the story in any way, but shockingly, there was only one.
Okay. That'll remain a mystery. I completely understand. This is actually another good question. Okay. This is from Lee. Sara talked about her and Tegan's high school experiences. Clea and Laura, what were you like in high school? All right, Laura, I'll start with you.
I was, I related a lot to the way Jen described herself. I was very overachieving. My decathlon was tennis, but everything else was pretty similar. I was like the only out kid in my high school. That was cool. Everybody really liked that a lot and treated me very well because of it. But yeah, I mean, I felt very similar to the characters on the show.
Clea, any insight on you as a high school kid?
I mean, I really was like an in the middle, or like I wasn't popular, but I wasn't unpopular. I had friends, but I really, like, it took me a while to really find my footing in high school. And like, I came out towards the end of high school, which I thought was going to be bad, but then it was great because I went to an art school where everybody just wanted to be weird and different. And they were like, God, I wish I had thought of that. it was, yeah.
Next question is from Janice. Okay, this is actually a really good question too. How did you sort out breaking down the totality of the memoir into a TV series and the pacing for this first season?
Laura, do you wanna start?
I feel like I don't remember at what point we knew this season was gonna end at the end of the school year, but I feel like we talked about that relatively early on, and there's some stuff from the memoir that takes place actually like later in the memoir or in a different spot that we ended up bringing into the first season. But that kind of framework, I think we established pretty early on. And then I would love to take credit for any of the pacing, but that was something that Clea had established before I got there. So I'm going to make her answer that part.
I mean, it was really just, I mean, you know, speaking to something that Laura touched on earlier, was really just not wanting to sensationalize it or try to like over-dramatize everything, really sort of letting everything play out in an authentic way. And then, you know, I think it was really the cast was so wonderful and so good on camera, like could really just sort of like sit in the moments and sit in the spaces. And it really just felt so powerful. So it was really, you know, once we got into the edit, about just like really letting the performances carry the show because they could.
Thank you for that. Okay, I think we've got time probably for one more. Oh, good. So Jen would like to know, okay, she said, I love that the show takes the memoir's structure and builds on it by bringing in Tegan and Sarah's parents and friends. What conversations were had about which characters' point of views to include in season one? And was there a character that surprised you while writing their point of view?
I mean, Laura, what do you think? I mean,
I think maybe, Maya, I feel like was, unless I'm misremembering, I don't remember Maya being like one of the first people that we talked about. I remember talking about Phoebe and Patrick, and then once we got to Maya, that was, I think, the surprise.
Yeah. Yeah. She's telling the truth.
We love the truth. Listen, it has been a pleasure to talk to all of you. Listen, let's put our fingers together, crossed for a season two. Just a reminder, everyone, you can catch the entire first season of High School. It is available to stream right now on Freevee. You can also watch it on Prime Video. But yes, it has been such a pleasure. And yeah, happy holidays to you all, and hope to see you soon.
Yes, thank you so much for doing this.
Thanks, everyone.
It's so nice to see you.